ideas and theories that were invented outside the African experience or in opposition to that experience? How does this intellectual react to ideas and theories evolved in the age of European imperialism? Ideas and theories whose central interest was to show up the power structure to legitimize imperialism and sustain its ascendancy. How does the African intellectual react to a world formation that either excluded Africa or relegated it to the margin? I believe that the task before the African intellectual as researchers and pedagogues is to find ways in their research practices and pedagogies to devise counter-hegemonic frameworks to contest the West as epistemological core, restructure terms of exchange, and ensure new epistemological cartographies, advocate a critical pedagogy that engenders liberation from hegemonic structures and institutional relationships, undo the asymmetry systems of knowledge production and dissemination, interrogate the universal application of globalized system of knowledge production and scholarship, create new platforms for research and paradigms of collaboration to build scholarly commons rather than pinnacles, and lastly, decenter hegemonic structures to catalyze progressive pedagogy and inspire progressive political action. Now we have the imperial hegemony that perpetrated state violence. We also have the academy as a site of different forms of hegemonies. Epistemologically, it's related to colonial hegemony. In terms of language, in fact, I was discussing in Edgewood, the very profound attempt the school is making to teach the local language. And that is important because language is not just a communicative skill, it carries with it the weight of the people, the weight of their minds, the way they see things, and the way they live things. The imposition of colonial language, English, French, Spanish, and all that, with some of our officialdom in Africa, is an effective tool in ensuring cultural hegemony. Language is much more than a communicative tool. It carries the weight of a particular worldview. The language of the colonizer structures what is communicated to the colonized and effectively limits what he or she knows. Their language limited us in so many ways. The other thing is theory. When you look at, and I have some proverbs here, I keep thinking about this proverb as we think theory, African proverbs. In Igbo land, we say, when something stands beside it. Our notion of duality. A person is a person because of other people, so the proverb. The sky is vast enough for birds to fly without colliding. Yoruba proverb, because the Yorubas, they looked up the sky and saw the birds flying in all types of formation. They just said, this place, it is too vast. They are not territorial. Everyone will fly. One head cannot go into council, Ashanti proverb. and another proverb, one does not stand at a spot to watch a masquerade. I don't know how masquerades are, but masquerades in Igbo land, they are linked to movement. So when you can't stand at a spot, you can't just watch it as you're watching your TV screen. You have to keep moving. So you have to be getting all sorts of perspective in anything. We see that in European discourses, there is a clear division of labor between the producers of information and the theorists of the universities, of the theorizers. We have producers of information, we have theorizers. And of course, who is superior? Theorizer. They have bigger, more effective brains. We producers of information, we have these puny, ineffective brains. But it is the work of the Benin philosopher, Pola Udonji, that forcefully analyzed the division of labor as unequal with a high-valued role of theorizer belonging almost exclusively to Westerners, while Africans are confined to gathering of raw information. Africa provides material, just like we produce raw material, and they take it over there to manufacture goods. The same problem, they get oil from Nigeria, palm oil, and go to Britain and produce palm olive soap. Theory makers and their methods and concepts constitute a community of people and shared meaning. Superior, superior, superior. Many decades ago, or not many, two decades ago, Barbara Christian, a black woman, reminded us that people of Africa, this African descent, that they theorize, but by they theorize differently. Vivian had told us about Africans as great storytellers. Now, she said, and I quote her, "I'm inclined to say that our theorizing, that is black people, is often in narrative forms, in the stories we create, in the riddles and proverbs, in the play with language, since dynamic rather than fixed ideas seem more to our liking. African proverbs encapsulate profound philosophical thought and are suited to the construction of theoretical frameworks. If the Cartesian cogito, that is the basis for the formulation of much of Western theory of rationality, the Enlightenment, I think, therefore, I am. If it can capture our imagination, why not the African proverbs, I am because we are? Or when something stands beside it. That is a theorizing of duality, but different, horizontal theorizing, as opposed to the vertical theorizing of Descartes. The location of African women, the way we have been seen, as knowledge producers in feminist epistemological quarrels, is both specific and complex. If you see some of the materials produced in feminist scholarship, even in Western scholarship, you always have the theorizing done by the people with the effective huge brains. Then, African women, if you're given a chance to participate, you will be dealing with the case study. And if you're from Lesotho, better talk about Lesotho. Don't go and talk about Nigeria. We don't and get into the theory writing. And we think that things have changed. No. This year, a book called The Feminist Theory Reader was published by Routledge. This year, there were 54 chapters, only one by Obioma Nnaemeka, and another one by Ndlovu. Two came from Africa south of the Sahara. Two out of 54. This year, the more things change, the more they remain the same. Let us look at the other hegemony. In the academy, we have this first one, theory, and the non-theory. The other one, which concerns many of us, is science and technology and the humanities, disciplinary hegemony. So, the last one. In disciplinary terms, the arts and humanities are at risk. As recently as 2005, the president of Nigeria, my native country, Olusegun Obasanjo, anxious to launch Nigeria into the community of industrialized nations, declared the humanities irrelevant, boasting that if he had had his way, he would stop universities from offering irrelevant courses such as mass communication and sociology, and steer students towards science-based courses. According to Obasanjo, and I quote him, "Some people came to me and they said they have 2 master's degrees and yet cannot get a job. Then I asked, 'What did you read?' And they replied, 'Mass communication. The other one is sociology.' Then I told them, 'You are uneducated. You now have to go and be re-educated to create value for your skill. I wonder what school this man went to.'" In the global knowledge economy, research and learning in the arts and humanities is increasingly regarded as a luxury and have sometimes been reduced to the status of handmade of science and technology. The general trend in higher education is towards privileging those disciplines most amenable to commercialization. Hence, the focus has been on STEM, science, technology, engineering, math, medicine, the STEM, and collaboration between these disciplines and universities and industry. But I differ with this position. Science and technology are important, but the arts and humanities play crucial roles in human development. The benefits of humanistic research include the vital role it plays in intellectual freedom, the indispensable service it provides through critical analysis, the provision of sense of place in history and the world, its function as a key player in public culture, the preservation and transmission of traditions from one generation to the next, the questioning and maintenance of ethic values, and thinking constructively about what the future may hold. If ever there were a time when society was in need of humanistic modes of inquiry, it is today. More than ever, we require the deep historical perspective and specialized knowledge of other cultures, regions, religions, and traditions provided by the humanities. And precisely because of the rapid developments in science and technology, we must think carefully about the nature of the human, the ethics of scientific investigation, and the global effects of technological change. The humanities can ask science questions that science cannot ask itself, the humanities can ask technology questions technology cannot ask itself. Often, particularly in Africa, it is through the arts and humanities, oral tradition, literature, painting, sculpture, visual and performing arts, it is through all these that people, especially us, we make sense of our world. Furthermore, it is through art, the arts, that women in Africa tell their stories, make sense of their world, and try to change it. Look at Wema art. Look at Uli art. Look at the art that NGOs have used for their advocacy work. Next one. Good. Now I have framed this. We have been excluded by colonial manipulation from the realm of theory. We have also been manipulated to think that Africa is a void. Now, how do we cannot all the time be the countries of resistance. We resist, but we cannot always be saying, we resist, therefore we are. We have to put something. What do we put in that void? And that is what this section is, building on the indigenous. How do we build on the indigenous? And I borrow this idea from the Nigerian political scientist, Claude Ake, who made a very powerful distinction between tradition and indigenous. See, tradition, indigenous is that not that reified entity that is locked up somewhere. We can always evoke it anytime. Tradition is dynamic, just like culture. It is the way we look at who we are at a particular moment in history. Ideas and initiatives relating to the need for Africa-centered knowledge, which is what we should be working for, cultural adaptation and Africanization, is hardly new in African studies that we should have African-centered knowledge. The advocacy for that is not new. We can go back to the 19th century. Many prominent Africans, including those in the diaspora, had called for the regeneration of African peoples through education that was rooted in African culture, tradition, environment, and history. Edward Blyden, a black West Indian who emigrated to Africa in 1851, led a crusade against European miseducation and cultural alienation of Africans in the last quarter of the 19th century. As a solution to mental slavery, Blyden demanded for the establishment of a university in West Africa, stressing that the curriculum should be adapted to African environment, culture, and tradition in order to avoid the training of mentally enslaved and culturally bastardized Africans. The work of other African scholars and philosophers, Cheikh Diop, Senegal, Paulin Utonji from Benin, V.Y. Mudimbe from Zaire, the Congo, Theophile Obenga, and all the late Nigerian political scientists I mentioned before, Claude Ake, all these great African scholars articulated this concern. I now move to African feminisms. We talk, using this context then, we talk about feminisms. I wouldn't really go so much into the Western feminism. I would just place it just within the history of feminist theorizing. What happened was in the 60s, during the civil rights movement, in fact, the 60s and late 50s and 60s, there were really turbulent period that harbored all